Salvete omnes, and welcome back. In this video, we are going to be continuing with Caesar in Book 6, this time looking through chapters 14 and 15, talking about the customs of the Gauls. Before we get started, as always, let's just do a quick recap of our color coding. Words in red indicate our subjects, anything in green is a verb, and words that show up in blue are direct objects of some sort. Likewise, anything that shows up in boldface type is the main thought or clause of the sentence, and anything showing up in not boldface type, which the sentence actually doesn't have, will be subordinate to that in some way. So, with that out of the way, let's dive right in. In Chapter 13, the start of the AP readings in Book 6, we learned about the Druids at some length after briefly talking about how there are two classes in Gaul, in Gallic society, of any note or number. One is the Druids, the other is the Knights. Obviously, we're not done talking about the Druids yet. As for the plebs, well, we don't really care about them, do we? They're practically slaves for a variety of reasons, so we are going to speak no more of them. Instead, let's pick up here in Chapter 14 and talk a little bit more about Druides. So, it turns out it's good to be a druid, it seems, because, as we learned straight away, druides abella besse consuerunt. So, the druids are accustomed to literally be away from war, so they don't participate in the fighting that the Gauls often engage in. Nor do they pay taxes, tributa. They don't pay taxes. Una cum reliquis. This una is adverbial when used with cum like this, so we say together with or along with or something like that. They don't pay taxes along with everyone else. They also, Caesar continues his habit of not giving us connectors when he's doing this more didactic writing, and they also have, the Druids, a vacationem militiae. So literally, I mean, a vacation from military matters. So again, they're not concerned with participating in military matters, serving in the military, and they also have immunitatem, I know, immunity, you know, they have an exception for or from, for the genitive here, omnium rerum, from all things, all right? So the Druids have a get-out-of-obligation-free card of a sort. Okay, well, perhaps unsurprisingly, tantis excitati primis, having been excited or enticed by such rewards, et sua sponte, and also of their own accord. Okay, these would be ablatives of means, right? Stirred up by means of such rewards, but also stirred up by their own free will. Multi, and this we just have to rely on the masculine here to tell us we're talking about people. Many people into this study, that would be the study to become a druid, they come, many people come into this study and also are sent by their parents and their, this would be something like neighbors literally, but it's more like relatives, okay, those who are close to them. Not everyone, you know, especially in a very warlike society, not everyone necessarily has a parent at home, so that would mean relatives, close relatives. All right, so people don't just come into it necessarily of their own accord or stirred up by the promise of rewards, but many of them are also sent to study to become druids by their parents and family members. Okay, we are talking about the multi still, okay? They are said, that's where we begin. They are said, but we're not going to go into any kind of oratio obliqua here necessarily because the ediscere just follows naturally from dicuntur. They are said to learn. They are said to learn a great number of verses there. There, ibi, would be in disciplina, right? In the study to become a druid. And versum, of course, is just a genitive with numerum, magnum numerum. The multi who come are said to study to learn a great number of verses. And yes, verses would be poetry. They study poetry. And so, some people, right, again, non nulli, not nobody, therefore some people stay in this disciplina, right, for, we have an accusative of duration of time, annos vicenos, for 20 years. And before you know, of course, before we get all, oh my gosh, they study for 20 years, that's fairly standard for modern people these days. Heck, in the modern world, people stay in school for more than 20 years. So, but they don't come out of it knowing a great number of verses. Okay, so if one is wondering why these people might go and study with the Druids for up to 20 years, learning, among other things, verses of poetry, why are they doing that? Well, Caesar explains a little bit for us. Let's start here with Existimant. This would presumably be the Gauls, think that, or they do not think, right? If you want to read the Neque with Existimant, that's fine too. That's how I did it. They do not think that it is right. Fas esse. Fas is indeclinable, so it always looks like fas. We're going to read it here as the accusative subject of esse in the indirect speech triggered by Existimant. They do not think that it is right. And then from here, we're going to jump down to here. Okay, so Existimant, we just kind of pretend it isn't there as we read. They do not think that it is right to entrust these things. What are the ea that we're talking about? Well, it is whatever the people learn in the disciplina of the Druids. Okay. They do not think that it is right to entrust these things to writing. We're not going to say to letters, to writing. And yes, literis is dative because mandare. It is not proper to entrust these things to writing. Let's scroll down here. Cum. Now, this cum, it does have a subjunctive. We see utantur down here. And once we read it, we're going to understand that this is actually a concessive cum. So the Gauls do not write down whatever goes on in the disciplina druidum, right, in the teaching of the Druids, although in, and here's this word fere again, so we're going to read it with reliquis, in nearly all other matters, that's kind of the force of reliquis, right, the leftover ones, the remaining ones, so we might just say in all other, in nearly all other matters, for, you know, that would be both, you know, matters both public and private. And again, we saw this in chapter 13. When we say publicus, right, publicis rationibus, we're talking about maybe public as in governmental or state affairs. So in state affairs and in private matters, they use Greek letters. They, presumably being the Gauls, who can read and write, use Greek letters. And you'll notice that this graikis literis is ablative, but it is the direct object because utor is one of those verbs. Utor is perhaps the most commonly occurring one of these verbs, these puff v verbs, they're frequently called for a mnemonic, puff v, puffy. They want ablatives as their object instead of accusatives. So it's not that the Gauls don't write things down. They do write things down, and they use the Greek alphabet when doing so. It's just that they don't entrust the things that the Druids teach to writing. Well, why not, you might be asking. Don't worry, Caesar has you covered. Id mihi duabas de causis instituisse videntur. Now, quick thing here, gotta watch out. This is videntur, not videtur. So it's not, we're not going to read this as it seems to me. No, no. Videntur. They, the Gauls, seem to have instituted this thing or practice. They seem to me to have instituted this practice duabus de causis for two reasons. And we're going to talk about the two reasons. One's here and one's here. So that's how that sets us up. So, the Gauls seem to me to have instituted this practice for two reasons. Because, unsurprisingly, a causal clause explaining. First reason, they do not want the disciplinam, and yes, we're reading disciplinam here as the accusative subject of efferi, because efferi is a passive verb, not an active verb, so it's not going to have an object, and it's not deponent, so... they do not want the teaching to be spread, we might say, literally efero, so to be carried forth in vulgum, into the crowd, into the common people, right? We don't want everyone knowing what the Druids teach, nor, scrolling down, right, so we can see the rest of the sentence, nor, and the wellint from up above, let's take a quick peek, ha-ha! Wellint, right? That's going to still be in force. So let's just hold the wellint in our minds as we come back down here. They also do not want the people who are studying, qui discunt, eos is the antecedent of qui, obviously. They do not want these people, eos, now let's do confessos literis first, trusting in writing, again, we're not going to say letters for literae, trusting in writing, okay, so these people, if they were to write all of this down, they might trust in that writing, have faith in that writing, and thus study their memoria less. So, and this use of studere here, it doesn't mean study necessarily the way we think of the word, but it means something more like to pay attention to, and that leads us to memoriae, the dative. So the idea here is that you would pay less attention, if that makes sense for studere. They might pay less attention to their memory, or to developing their memory, we might say, if they are confessos literis, if they are relying on writing. And Caesar goes on to explain, right, he shares kind of a personal opinion, perhaps. This is a thing, you could just say because, right, or this could be a factual quote. This is a thing which happens to nearly everyone, right? Again, we're seeing a lot of ferres in this, in book six, to nearly, not quite everyone, but to many. Ferre makes it a little tricky for the plerry. In English, we want to say to nearly everyone. That's kind of our idiom. Here in Latin, with ferre plerisque, it's more like to nearly many people. That, this is a result clause, of course, because accidit wants a result clause. What is the result that occurs for nearly many people who trust writing? Well, by means of the guard of writing, so like a defense, like writing is a defense that protects you from having to develop your memory, they, something like, it doesn't mean send away literally, but they lose, we might say. They lose their diligence in studying, and they lose their memory or their ability to remember. So this happens, and so if we read backwards, right, this is the sort of thing that happens by means of a guard of writing. It happens to practically a lot of people, very many people, who are trusting in or relying upon writing when they're studying. So that's why, in Caesar's opinion, the Gauls do not permit the teaching of the Druids to be written down. So those of you who might perhaps be watching these videos and fiendishly taking notes of everything that's going on, Caesar might not agree with your chosen path of study. Tisk, tisk. All right, moving on. Now that we've gotten that out of the way, let's talk a little bit about what the Gauls are actually teaching, or at least that Caesar has heard. In primis, this is an idiom in Latin, something like first of all, we would say in English. So in the first place, first of all, they, this would be the Gauls, presumably, or the Druids, want to persuade this. And then hoc is the object of persuadere, but it's also referring to this that follows, right? So they want to teach this thing. What is the thing? Well, the thing is that, indirect speech, souls, animas, do not die, non interire, but from some, after death, they pass to others. So, of course, we're, you know, from some people to other people, we're talking about reincarnation. And, let's scroll down so we can see the whole thing more clearly, and they think, this again would be the Gauls or the Druids, they think that, and here we have, we can just toss off this appellative absolute really quick, with the fear of death being ignored, or having been removed, perhaps, for neglecto, they think that, and we have to understand, there's no subject expressed here for excitari, which is a passive infinitive, so we need something, we need a subject, we need something or someone to be excited, so we're just going to say people. People will be excited or stirred up by this thing. Hawk is an appellative of means. What is the hawk? That would be this bit up here, that souls don't die, but in fact are reincarnated. They think that by means of this thing, people will be driven exceptionally, or very, very much, towards courage, Right, and of course, given the way we've seen virtus used in Caesar, we know that we're talking about military courage, so courage in war. So that aside, we can see that the Gauls, the Druids, apparently also teach a great many other things, and that, you know, multa praeterea. Furthermore, right, they disputant. Now, this doesn't necessarily have to mean dispute, but it's more like they teach or discuss or argue about, you know, in argue in the sense of seeking to find the truth. They teach many, many things. And then we see the sorts of things they're talking about. They're talking about the stars and their motion. We're talking about the size of the earth and the lands. All right, so mundus here would be the earth, so we think of maybe as the totality, the globe. But terrarum would be the lands or territories on the globe. So how big is Italia? How big is Gallia? How big is the region of the Carnutes, et cetera, et cetera. They also talk about rerum natura. This would literally just be nature or natural science, right? Literally the nature of things. And they talk a great deal about the force and power of the immortal gods. And what's the difference between force and power? This isn't really a Hendiades. Okay, don't be tricked. Vis is perhaps physical force, whereas potestate is perhaps the abilities or limitations of the gods. So how much physical force do the gods have, and what exactly can they do? They disputant, multa, so they discuss a lot or frequently these things, and they also hand these things down, we would say, literally hand over, trotto, to give to hand over to. They pass these things down to the youth, right? A simple dative, indirect object, because tradunt. Okay, well, that was all straightforward and simple, and sure enough, apparently it's time now to talk about the equites, the other class, we might say, the other class of society are of the equites. The other class is of the equites. Okay, so he, that would be the equites, cum est usus aliquod bellum incidit. So cum with est, these are indicatives, so we know when. The idea of est usus is being joined with aliquod bellum incidit. So when there is a need, that would be est usus, we've seen usus est before, and when, the cum is still in force, any old war starts. So this is interesting, because the knights, as we're going to see, are the military class. They do the fighting. So when would you do fighting? Well, obviously when there's a war, but also with this initial expression, just when there's a need. So maybe it's not a full-blown war. Maybe we're just raiding somebody or some such. Maybe there's some other reason why we might need the military. They're the ones who come out, the equites. But let's talk about war for a second here, and let's scroll down so that we can see the whole thing. Which, when a war started, which customarily happened, so that would be a war, right? Wars customarily happened, ferre, again, ferre. This ferre we're going to read with quotanis, nearly every year. Or again, kind of very, very frequently, nearly very, very frequently, nearly every year, ante Caesaris adventum. Oh my, before the coming of Caesar. So apparently it's better now? Uti, continuing on, right? These are the wars that would happen when, basically. So, yes, uti is just ut, and this is a result clause triggered by acidere. So, you know, the wars would customarily happen. The result was that, right, they would either bring some attack on others, or they would repulse attacks brought against them. Remember that illatus is in ferro. When we read it, since we're talking about how often the wars happened, it oftentimes just is easier in English to just slide in with a when. All right, even though grammatically, yes, technically, this is an ut clause with subjunctives going off of acidere. Right, wars would customarily occur, you know, so that they could either attack someone else or repulse an attack brought against them. When they would do it, it's not worth getting ourselves in a twist over. When this happened, though, so either when there was a need or when a war started, scroll down to the rest. Omnes, this omnes modifies the he that we started this sentence with. All of the equites would, you know, take part, excuse me, present tense, right? They take part in war or in the fighting. And so You might be looking at this oot and thinking, wait a second, why isn't that indicated as a subordinate expression in some way? Because it's oot, right? Well, in this particular sentence, ita and oot are being used as correlatives. That would be as if they were tantus and quantus, or quot and tot, and so on and so forth. So in this case, we're not starting an oot clause or anything like that. We're simply establishing a relational statement. So just as each of the nights, or any given night, right, is most notable for his rank and his resources, thus he has more dependents and clients around him. So hopefully you see the relationship here that's being set up, the correlative relationship between oot and ita. We might instead say, you know, the more renowned the person is for his birth and his wealth, that many more dependents and clients he'll have around him. Okay, so the idea being that among the equites, as you rise in rank, or as you are, you know, born into a higher rank, perhaps, you correspondingly have that many more dependents and clients around you. Okay, so that's how the oot and the ita are working here. We're not setting up any kind of subordinate clauses here or anything like that. We're just simply establishing a relationship between these two ideas. So, last statement here about the equites. Hanc unam gratiam potentiamque noerunt. They know. This is from the verb nosco. It's a perfect tense. Nosco, noscere, novi. They know or recognize or understand. Only, we know from experience that unus, when used, oftentimes means something more like solus. So the Gauls, or the equites, recognize only this influence and power. You know, it seems kind of unfair, but to our modern sensibilities, but how does one gain influence and power in Gaul? Well, apparently, at least among the equites, apparently you either have to be born into it or you have to acquire it, because as Caesar mentioned above, the more wealthy or powerful you are in respect to your rank or your wealth, genere or copiis, that's how you get more people around you. That's how you get more dependents and more clients. And this is the only type of influence and power that they know of, that they recognize. So, if you want to rise among the equites, that's how you do it. You either get born into it or you find a way to get rich. Okay, so with that, we have come to the end of chapters 14 and 15. And we're done talking about the Druides, it seems, and we might be done talking about the Equites, too. There's not a whole lot to say, but we will be continuing on and talking about a variety of other customs of the Gauls in the next video. Maximus gratias for making it this far, and valete!